Welcome and thank you for joining my presentation. I am Janis Petersen from the BZI, Berliner Zentrum Industriekultur, and I will talk about the transformation of Oberschöne Weide, an area in Berlin that was and still is heavily affected by its industrial heritage. We will take a look at Oberschöne Weide becoming a vibrant mixed-use place and the question how this came to be. I will start by giving a very quick historical outline which will also help us understand the processes of the recent years of Oberschöne Weide's history. Next, I will talk about the different programs and initiatives that have been since the 90s and, respectively, some of the involved players. Lastly, we will take a look at the current situation and at work and visions still ahead of us. So if I say Schöne Weide, I talk about this area. As you can see, it is far on the outskirts of Berlin. Schöne Weide is separated by the river Spree in Oberschöne Weide, Upper Schöne Weide, and Niederschöne Weide, Lower Schöne Weide. I will mostly focus on Upper Schöne Weide. One of the first mentions of Schöne Weide was in 1598, where it says, "Bei der schönen Weide," which roughly translates to "at the beautiful meadow." And that it was, just a big beautiful meadow, with huge taverns that the people of the surrounding cities and villages like to escape to in their free time. Here you see a postal card from 1896 that depicts the recreational image of the area until then. Then, following the ever so quickly accelerating growth of industrial areas, the populace of Berlin faced trouble finding space for industrial buildings in the inner city. Industry needed transportation, water, and a place to grow. And Schöne Weide had just exactly that. So in 1896, Walter Rathenau, famous founder of AEG, bought 92,000 square meters of land and settled his production on Oberschöne Weide. And with them came a massive amount of different industrial companies. In this map from 1907, you can see the growth of Schöne Weide compared to the 1871 map with a train station and lines in the lower left part of the map, industrial areas around the river of Spree, and living quarters in the upper Oberschöne Weide part of the map. For matters of comparison, here are the two maps next to each other. So, let's continue by taking a look at Oberschöne Weide in numbers. As you can see, the area started out with just a few residents. But till 1895, there was a good increase of 450 residents. So, looking at just another 5 years, the increment was huge. This is in no doubt in correlation with the settlement of the industry. At the turn of the century, Schöne Weide became the birthplace of German electricity, granting the place the name Elektropolis. Now, looking at just another 20 years, you can see that Oberschöne Weide grew massively. Let's take a jump to after the World War and the separation of Berlin. In 1990, there were still 25,000 people working in Oberschöne Weide. The GDR upheld the production in Schöne Weide till then to its full extent. So just 1 year after the reunion, the former East Berlin companies couldn't hold up to the new market and had to close down. A lot of people lost their job, residents moved out. The spiral held up to the circa mid-2010s, until Oberschöne Weide began to flourish again, as you can see in the rising number of residents. So, we gotta ask ourselves, what imprint did this leave on the region? As mentioned earlier, the industry brought electricity, and with that, light to Schöne Weide and Berlin. This is just one example of AEG representing itself as a bringer of light, using electricity to lighten the city, granting Schöne Weide, and vice versa, Berlin the nickname of Electropolis. Though, at some point in the 20th century, people started calling Schöne Weide Schweineöde, a name shift that still is around some rare times today. Schweineöde would roughly translate to pig's barren land or pig's desert. So we could say that the image of being a recreational hotspot on Electropolis has long been lost. But how did this malapropism to Schweineöde happen? Now, the rising unemployment and the high amount of uninhabited properties and factory premises that were left dereliction surely left a heavy imprint on the local populace. But the unemployment didn't happen till the 1990s. So what did happen before that? Since the 60s, the DDR planned to reconstruct Schöneweide heavily. For instance, they planned an underground train station to Schöneweide. But the big plans, they never happen. So because of that, the residential area and the industrial area just lingered and weren't reconstructed or renovated either. In Anja Stich's resident interviews from 1999 to 2000, some of the people mentioned that the facades grew dark by the heavy smog and the local freight train, nicknamed the Bull, as you can see on the lower left picture, it was heavy and loud, shaking the ground as it moved. But then again, Schöneweide didn't remain the barren land. It made a transformation. So let's take a look at what happened since the 90s. In these two pictures, I would like to depict the difference in workload between 1990 and 2010 in Oberschöneweide. The area depicts the KVO area, Kabelwerk Oberspree, which would translate to Cable Factories Oberspree. As you can see in the lower left picture from 1990, you can see a lot of cable drums lying around on the premises. Those cable drums have also been produced in that area. Then in the picture on the right from 2010, all those cable drums are gone. This is because a university moved into the premises of the area. Now let's take a look at the initiatives that happened since the 90s. In 1993, Berlin released the Leitsätze zur Stadterneuerung Berlin, which would roughly translate to Guiding Principles to Renew the City of Berlin. For the area of Schöneweide, a whole bunch of conferences were held and examinations released. Among those were the strategies for Oberschöneweide. The strategies focused mainly on renewal of the 19th century houses, which for instance, till then, still had shared bathrooms between several flats. In 1995, a citywide bill was released to secure former tenants a right to regain the domiciles. This bill had a running time till 2005. In 1999, the Neighborhood Management Program started as part of the EVRY Social City Program. Social City has been renamed to Social Cohesion Program in 2019. We will take a look at key points of the program in a second. From 2011 to 2015, the Schöneweide Kreativ project was funded. Schöneweide Kreativ aimed at, and also they realized, at connecting local actors of the creative scene. For instance, designers, artists and musicians, and also they strengthened the local and citywide reputation, for instance with an art festival. At the same time, the 2011 to 2020 Senate-funded regional management was a very big player. Like its predecessor, the neighborhood management, the regional management also focused on Upper Schöneweide, just on a bigger scale, meaning they focused on the whole of Schöneweide, also Lower Schöneweide. Many of the key points we will look at in a second were also true for the regional management. Also, the regional management took over supporting the local creative scene after the Schöneweide Kreativ project ended. So, with that, there's a well-known problem in Berlin that occurred before in different districts. That when the district emancipates itself and becomes interesting for investors, the less wealthy creative scene that was a key factor in the district's image building in the first place is getting displaced. Since the fear of this was very real in Schöneweide in the mid-2010s, the regional management, together with the organized creative scene, released the Master Plan Art. The Master Plan Art aimed at securing permanent locations for actors of the scene. In this slide, We see some graphics depicting a few of the key preconditions to the Social City program. As mentioned before, it was renamed to Social Cohesion in 2019. In this case, I would only like to point out the mixed composition of the council, with a slight favor of local residents. Also, I would like to point out the requirement of an ongoing monitoring and evaluation. In the official English document concerning the Social City program in Berlin, it states that these socially disadvantaged areas were found to be affected by a demonstrable neglect of public areas, roads, squares, and green spaces, as well as social infrastructural deficits. All district residents are invited to participate in discussion and outlining of a strategy. Also, it states that to initiate projects that help residents and businesses in identifying themselves with a district and motivate them to further their own district. So, looking at the requirements to be EFRI funded, the neighborhood management in 1999 developed a strategy recognizing some of the key problems blocking a revitalization of Oberschöneweide. Let's take a look at those key problems. Hence, these are the solutions. For this matter, I represent them in a simplified manner. One, to make industry areas accessible to the residents. Two, to get galleries, museums, and educational institutes in the area. This again will lead to a settling of cafes and retail shops. Three, to connect the areas of Oberschöneweide and Niederschöneweide by building bridges. 4. Building a promenade along the waterfront. 5. Connecting the promenade, the bridges, and the center marketplace. And 6. To reuse a historical reputation. This could either be the recreational reputation mentioned earlier or the reputation as being a technology hub. At the picture to the right, you see the successful concept of reorganizing the main street, allowing room for every traffic participant. Earlier I mentioned the bullet train that was loud and heavy and shaking the ground. Connecting Upper Schöneweide to Lower Schöneweide was an early factor to increase infrastructure attractiveness. Hence, the Minatoden-Hagen Bridge was constructed between 2013 in 2017, and the pedestrian bridge Kaisersteg was constructed between 2005 to 2007. This was essentially doubling the amount of bridges from 2 to 4. In this picture, we can see 3 of the important infrastructure key points. 1. The building of the bridge Kaisersteg, outlined by the yellow. That too connects to a center marketplace, the blue square, as well as 3, a recreational area, outlined by the waterside boulevard in green. A main part of the concept since 1993 was to remove the barrier and make the waterfront area accessible to all residents. Sadly, this only succeeded in half. A part of the planned promenade is, as of today, still cut off by companies that don't want people crossing their premises, here outlined in red. Let's take a look at the next key point, culture and education. Hands down, the biggest coup was the settling of the HTV, University of Applied Sciences, into the biggest industry complex in 2006, which you can see on the picture at the upper left. With the university came thousands of young students, and in return the students attracted retail and culture, cafes and restaurants. Also, the students found affordable living accommodations nearby. A former electricity transformer company came at dawn, right next to the university. In 2009, the museum called Industriesalon established itself in an older factory building. The people of Industriesalon heavily supported all following initiatives and established themselves as a key player at networking the local residents and companies, as well as researching the place's history. Furthermore, the settling of the university had the side effect that the professors and students launched seminars that interacted with the landscape of Schöneweide, one of them being the yet unrealized memorial called Denkzeichen, as you can see on the picture on the lower left, which uses history in a playful interactive manner. The Industry Salon had similar plans of authentic sound and photography installations all over the district. In this slide, you can see the Industry Salon's current project of establishing a landmark called Elektra at the center marketplace, earlier depicted in a blue square. Here is a picture of the huge gallery Rheinberghallen. I use this picture as a representative for the creative community mentioned earlier. In this respect, I would like to mention that Brian Adams bought an older factory building nearby and made a gallery for the elite out of it. The internationally renowned artist Olof Eliasson established a gallery in Oberschöneweide too. On one hand, this is a representative for the success of making Oberschöneweide attractive. On the other hand, this is a turning point, since too many investors could mean a raise of local rent and a displacement of existing retail and culture, as pointed out by the Regional Management's final report of 2017. Another example of success is the old Bärenquell Brewery, which was just recently restarted as a mixed-use area with a tavern, a flea market, an organic market, an open-air cinema and a club. By the way, they succeeded by launching a social media campaign highlighting the urban art that is hidden everywhere in the buildings and integrating the urban art in their concept. And this leads us directly to one of the most important factors, image. All the papers concerning Schöneweide since 1993 were talking image. Let's shake off the cacophony of Schweineöde and re-establish ourselves. There are different concepts and possibilities to garner from. Schöneweide as the recreational green leisure hotspot, as mentioned earlier, or Schöneweide as the electropolis, the bustling, shining technology hub. Well, the decision was made in favor of electropolis. No doubt, to use the image favorably, historical research was important too. Good thing a university and a museum settled nearby. If you search for Schöneweide and Electropolis, you will find many, many examples on the internet. Here I just took three different screenshots. And it needs to be said that by now every second local company is using the word Electropolis, and it's in very high danger of becoming kitsch. So, lastly, let's take a short look at what's ahead for Schöneweide. The company called DAG bought an area around the old car factory NAG in 2019, which has been a mixed use of trades and offices since 2010. DAG is planning a center for science and technology, meaning spaces are being rented out for technology-oriented businesses. As you can see, DAG is using the old idea of a technological progression that Schöneweide once represented. Also, DAG considers financing another bridge, connecting the area to the train station of Oberspree near Adlershof. By the way, Adlershof also gained a very respected image of being a technology hub over the past couple of years, with many startups settling in the area. Additionally, DAG wants to finally remove the fences and open the area to everyone as a walk-through area. This means they will finally open another path of the Waterside Boulevard. Lastly, they pursue a green strategy, which obviously is in line with the technological progressive image that Schöneweide as a whole pursues. And this leads us directly to an interview given by Christoph Rauhut, head of conservation for the region of Berlin, who stated that repurposing industrial buildings is in line with the green strategy, and hence rebuilding is not. And with that, I would like to thank you for listening. I am Janis Petersen, and I am working at the Berliner Zentrum Industriekultur, which in fact came into existence as a project between the HTW, University of Applied Sciences in Oberschöneweide, and the Deutsches Technikmuseum, German Museum for Technology in Berlin, in the year of 2011.